Welcome to Conway. We couldn't be happier to have all of you here. And to my Senate colleagues, it's great to have you in the region. I'm going to let John O'Rourke do a quick hello. He's a Conway Select Board member. Go ahead.
Thank you, Adam. I'm John O'Rourke. I'm chairman of the Board of Selectmen here in Conway. First off, I want to apologize to our handicapped members of town who could not get up here to this level. We were originally supposed to have this event in our church, our UCC, United Congregational Church, and unfortunately, in the tornado that came through on February 25th, that was severely damaged. We had to move it to this building. We originally started with downstairs, and then when we found out how many people were going to be here, we had to move it upstairs. So first, apologies for that. Let me introduce Bob Baker. Bob's on our select board. Bob's also our fire chief, and Bob was our incident commander during the hurricane emergency. He did an outstanding job. We have Bob on for a walk on the select board. Bob is going to act downstairs by the ladies and men's room to make sure that everything is okay. All right, and he's also on our select board. Tom Hutchison's our town administrator. We came through the tornado very well. We had tremendous help from the state and from mutual aid, and we're almost back to normal. Welcome to Conway, and we'll let it get going here.
Great. We're going to have the panelists introduce themselves as they speak to save time, but I do want to thank them all for traveling a long way in many instances, and because I think it's worth it, for not least, is the fact that you have a third of the Massachusetts Senate here and listening to what we're grappling with every single day out here. I think it's worth each member of the Senate just saying their name and their district so you get a sense of the Commonwealth that's represented here. I think we should probably start with the Senate President.
Sam Rosenberg, I'm from Amherst.
And then we might as well go down the line here.
Sure. Jim Welch, I represent the Hamden District just down the road, West Springfield, Springfield, and Chicopee.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Don Humison. I'm from Westfield. I have the second Hamden in Hampshire Senate District, 11 towns from Agawam to East Hampton.
John Keenan from the city of Quincy, representing Quincy, Braintree, Abington, Rockland, and Holbrook.
I'm Eric Lesser from the first Hamden in Hampshire District. I live in Longmeadow. District also includes Springfield, Chicopee, Hamden, East Longmeadow, Wolverham, Ludlow, Granby, and Doctortown.
Tom McGee, I represent Lynn, Marblehead, Swampscott, Nahant, Saugus, and Linfield.
Mike Barrett from Lexington, I represent Lexington and Concord, Waltham, and six additional towns in Middlesex County.
I'm Harriet Chandler, I represent Central Massachusetts, Worcester, and six other communities surrounding Worcester.
Good morning, State Senator Jamie Elders, Middlesex and Worcester District, the Shirley, Acton, Marlborough area.
Hi everyone, I'm Jason Lewis, I live in Winchester, and my district is just north of Boston.
Good morning, I'm from the 1st Bristol and Plymouth District, Greater Fall River, seven communities on the south coast.
Julian Sear, I'm from Truro, and I'm the state senator who represents Cape Cod, Martha's Vineyard, and Nantucket, so fellow hinterland communities.
Good morning, my name is Joe Boncori, I'm from Winthrop. I represent 1st Suffolk and Middlesex, which includes the city of Revere, city of Cambridge, and the city of Boston.
That's great, I think that's everyone. As you can see, we took a slightly different approach to our Commonwealth conversation stop. We decided that it's really important to get the narrative to my Senate colleagues and to the public in general about what we're struggling with basically on every single day. Essentially, we feel like we're at a bit of a crossroads. On the one hand, we see a lot of positive developments. You can think about cultural expansions in our institutions. Mass MoCA, Tanglewood is about to do a major expansion. The Clark Museum of Williamstown, great stuff. And that has a huge impact on our economy. General Dynamics, they do the electronics on all of our nuclear fleet in the United States and then battleships as well. Big company in Great Barrington, Pittsfield, expanding beyond the 1,400 jobs they already have. And we have a great narrative around access to nature and the like. But yet, at the same time, some of our fundamentals are just really deeply concerning. You'll hear today about population decline and the impact that has on our student enrollment in schools, and then in turn that snowballs into how do you maintain a quality curriculum while your student enrollment goes down, you have fixed costs, et cetera. And you can just see where that keeps going. People want to move to a town where the school is experiencing challenges and impacts on workforce and down the line. And so as we're trying to right the ship on some of these fundamentals, we don't even have the basic infrastructure in place to do that. Think high-speed internet, think transportation around the region or to and from some of the economic centers around the state and the region. And so we thought it was important to get the people who are dealing with this every single day, a lot of the regional planners and other leaders in the region, to essentially get that dynamic really so we're all conversant in it. So you'll hear a little bits of it. We're going to have to be very dynamic and quick. So I apologize for that. We'll be a little more of a roundtable conversation, let's say. But there are some takeaways that, you know, ultimately a small investment goes a long way out here. We think that as we're working through the process with MBI for internet, for example, there still might be a handful of towns that just need an additional boost fiscally. But there are other things. We're going to hear about shared services and potential incentives that could be used in that process. And so why don't we kick it off? Tom, I think you're going to go first. Is that right?
Okay. Senator Hyatt asked me to talk a little bit about some background.
If you could, I promised that you would introduce yourself at the start of every time you speak. So say your name and who you represent.
Right. My name is Tom Matusko, and I represent the Berkshire Regional Planning Commission. We are the planning commission for the 32 municipalities in Berkshire County. And Senator Hines asked me to provide some background information about the region and some of the changes that have been going through. I think much of the audience will know this, but for those who aren't that familiar with it, it'll be maybe a little bit new. So we're a region of small towns, the 101 communities in Western Mass. Two-thirds of them are under 5,000 population. Right away, that's different than the eastern part of the state. And when you get to Berkshire and Franklin County, we're even more rural. We have about 20% of the land mass, but only about 3% of the state's population. So we've got some very small towns. The town of Monroe has got more or less 100 people, right, Linda? And while these counties, particularly Berkshire and Franklin County, have been rural, there have been some important trends that I want to highlight a little bit. Population decline, Senator Hines mentioned this, between 2000 and 2016, populations of Berkshire and Franklin counties lost about 4% of the population. This is while the state gained overall 4%. So we're kind of falling further behind in population. But some of the trends are related to the composition of that population. We have a missing population cohort. Our young adults, those 20 to 39-year-old, between this time period, 2000 to 2016, that age group declined by about 11%. Our school-aged children during that time period decreased as well, declined about 24%. This has some impacts that you'll see later on. And then seniors, our population is getting older. We're continually leading the state in our elderly population. And with our projections, we see those trends going forward. So what does that mean? What are some of the highlight impacts? I think on municipal services, the changing demographics make it challenging to provide those services and the ability to pay for those services and the demand for new services. Volunteers in these small towns provide a lot of the different services, whether they be working on boards or committees or volunteer fire departments. We're having a hard time staffing some of those positions as our population ages as there are less of us. Paying for services. It's getting increasingly harder to pay for those services through municipal budgets. With a smaller number of taxpayers, the burden is spread to those who are here. And many of those are the elderly, and they're on fixed incomes, and harder for those to kind of adjust to increased taxes. As well, excuse me, a number of communities are facing their 2.5% limit. We've got 11 communities who are already taxing 2% of their total assessed value. This means that if they wanted to raise taxes to pay for services, they wouldn't be able to do that. And then there'll be new services that demanded from some of the elderly folks as the population changes. Related to educational services, in Berkshire County, it's really dramatic, and I don't have some of the information for Franklin County, but we've lost a net of six different schools over the last few years, elementary schools and some middle schools. And if you've been through a school closure as a community, you know how disruptive that can be. But also, I think the bigger deal with having fewer children is the quality of the educational service that we're able to provide to make sure that our children have an opportunity to succeed and thrive going forward. We want to make sure we give them all the opportunity, and it's becoming even more challenging. I think someone else will speak to that greater. And then economic impacts. There are fewer replacement workers. We have a great number of people who will be retiring in the next 10 years, and we're going to have a shortage, somewhere around 7,000 jobs just to fill those retiring positions. And with a shortage of the younger workers, it's harder to attract some new industries and businesses. So that's a snapshot. Like I said, I think a lot of people know about that, and our agency, in some ways, has been called the doom and gloom group, but I'll let other people speak to the opportunities. So.
Thanks for that, Tom. And there are three counties in the Commonwealth with a declining population. Two of them are in this district, Franklin and Berkshire, and Senator Sear has the other. So you're right, the Hinterland Congress. Linda, do you want to talk a little bit about the internet side?
Yep. I'm Linda Dunleavy from the Franklin Regional Council of Governments. We serve the 26 towns of Franklin County. And in 2 to 3 minutes, I'll tell you the 20-year history of broadband.
But really, take your time.
In the mid-1990s, we recognized that there was broadband inequity. While areas in eastern Massachusetts were seeing expansion of broadband and broadband getting faster, there were residences and businesses in Franklin County and all of western Mass with no broadband at all. This was creating broadband inequity, but also economic, social, and educational inequity, as broadband has become an increasingly vital aspect of working in school. So we have 44 communities still without broadband. These are the hardest communities to bring broadband to because they have the lowest population density. Not a good business case for the private sector, very expensive for the public sector. So I'm going to quickly tell you what we've done, thanks to you. In 2008, we created the Massachusetts Broadband Institute, funded with $40 million of bond funding. That and federal stimulus funding was used to build an 1,100-mile middle-mile network, an incredible infrastructure asset to central and western Massachusetts, horribly underutilized right now. You may have heard that last week the operator of the middle-mile network announced bankruptcy. I think that's actually an opportunity for Massachusetts to restructure that deal to be better for the operator and better for the communities that need to use that middle mile infrastructure. That infrastructure still wasn't enough to lure the private sector to the small towns of Massachusetts. So, thank you again. You allocated another $50 million for last mile broadband. $5 million for 9 underserved towns, towns that had cable but less than 96% coverage, which is the average in Massachusetts. Those towns are being upgraded now. $40 million for the 45 unserved communities and $5 million for the administration of the Massachusetts Broadband Institute. Lots has been accomplished. We are left with 37 communities that are working. Several towns are underway building their own networks. 37 communities left right now with the following choices at this point in time. May change today. I'm missing an MBI Board of Directors meeting to be with you today. Right now, towns will have a choice, hopefully announced next week, that through EOHED, towns can get grant funds through the MassWorks program if they want to own their own network. For most towns that pick this option will likely go with Westfield Gas and Electric, who will be the owner's project manager, who will design and build the infrastructure. Towns will then need to find an operator. They'll either do that individually or collectively through Wired West or another entity. Towns that don't want to own their infrastructure, MBI is trying to negotiate a deal with two private companies that would own the network and provide services to these municipalities. Those negotiations aren't done yet, hopefully will be soon. What is unclear right now is for the towns that may want to own their infrastructure but don't feel they have the capacity to manage a Mass Works grant. And let me be clear on all of this. The state funding is a huge help to our towns, but will only fund 25 to 33% of the cost of the network. These towns, the smallest towns in Massachusetts, have voted to tax themselves to solve this problem and to own and operate a broadband network on their own. That's a huge ask of the smallest towns in Massachusetts. How long was that?
Whew, that's impressive. That's good. And April will be a key month, it seems, as we're kind of coming in for a landing on the working with the private sector responses and decisions for the towns. Thanks again. Dave, did you want to talk about transportation?
Certainly.
Even if you don't, can you?
Yes.
Great, go for it.
Good morning, I'm Dave Christopoulos. I'm here as a resident of Goshen, as well as the executive director of the Hilltown CDC. I want to thank our legislators who came out from Eastern Mass to visit. Really appreciate that. It means a lot to us. So the Senator asked me to talk a little bit about transportation. I'm by no means an expert on transportation, but what I can tell you is I have been looking at it for about a year and a half now in the region that I spend the most time in, which is known as the Hilltowns. The Hilltowns are defined in different ways depending on who you are and where you live, but they're pretty much covers a lot of what we heard earlier around the smaller population towns that run up and down Western Mass. Particularly in the area that I look at, the towns are even lower population. Goshen's about 1,000 people, about 500 homes. So we have a real design issue to look at in the Hilltowns, transportation being a real challenge to try to figure out how to make it cost effective and still serve the needs of the population. I would say any of these things that we're talking about are probably not mutually exclusive. They all kind of have to tie together in some way to make them work. So that, you know, the broadband is probably the most important economic development thing that can happen right now for us out here. And transportation is, you know, something that just doesn't really exist in a comprehensive way in a lot of our towns. There tends to be running out of the population centers through the transit authorities. And so the little towns have struggled for years to try to figure out a way to create a service that is cost effective and still meets the needs of the folks. We have with this growing elderly population, we feel an obligation to really make sure that we can provide transportation to folks who need to get to, you know, essential services, hospital, doctor's appointments, grocery shopping, those kinds of things, and we really believe that that is the right thing to do. It helps people age in place and preserves our community. We really need to take care of the older folks in our towns, have all the history and knowledge, and are the leaders. So transportation gets to that issue, but I wanted to really, I think that there's a real interest in Western Mass in general for innovation in transportation. Now, I don't think we should just limit ourselves to, you know, what exists through the transit authority. I think there's a real interest in how it impacts the environment, how we can look at alternative technologies. Again, broadband's so important because there are other things you can do once you have that system in place to encourage the use of technology to defray the cost of transportation. People in the cities are using smartphones and all kinds of things to get transportation services. So these things are linked together. My organization is going to be taking over a van with the transit authority to try to see if we can improve on what exists now. But I'm hoping that we'll you know, we're already starting a conversation in the Hilltowns that getting more people involved in transportation is a really important component to our bigger picture. And I'm hoping that we can look at not just the safety net piece, but we can really look at how can we encourage people who are already motivated to use fuel-efficient cars, to use electric cars, to encourage commuting. There's a program that's promoted by the Department of Transportation called New Rides. A lot of people don't know about it, but it's an online service. Again, we need the internet, but it's an online service where people can link up. My wife, for example, drives from Goshen to Dalton. She works at Crane, another really great employer in the Berkshires. Every day she drives a half hour. I'm certain that there are other people going the same way. We connect these people in rural Massachusetts, we could do commuting as well. So I think transportation has a lot of possibilities, but we need support from the state government, and you know, we need to sit down and talk about this with you guys to make it, you know, the best program we can, or service we can.
There are a lot of interesting conversations happening about kind of a hybrid between what you do with RTAs and maybe some of the on-demand transportation options, and I know that it's happening in Franklin County, Hampshire County, and in Berkshire. MCLA is on the verge of leading a design workshop thinking process through that as well.
The last thing I'd say is, yeah, I do think that there is a way to kind of think about reciprocity between the population centers of Pittsfield, Greenfield, Northampton, Amherst, whatever, and how we can connect, the small towns can connect, because there's got to be some, there's opportunities there that we're probably not taking advantage of, because it's a little bit difficult to imagine, but I think it's important to be thinking that way.
I can feel Senator Lesser's eyes on me. We're talking about transportation and rail hasn't come up yet. That's another element that is absolutely on the tip of everyone's tongue when we are talking about this, is how we link with Boston in a more effective way, how we link with even New York City.
That's later this afternoon.
Free economic development. Pardon?
That's later this afternoon.
That's right. Todd.
Energy.
Energy.
Sure. Great. Yeah. Thank you all for coming. My name is Todd Ford. I'm the Executive Director of the Hampshire Council of Governments. Under our umbrella, we also have Hampshire Power, which is the state's only government-owned electricity supply entity. We currently have 90,000 customers as far as Lowell and Haverhill and also in the Berkshires. So I want to talk about the cost of electricity and energy, talk about the overall cost here in the Commonwealth, the regional differences in cost with electricity, and where our money goes. So we all know that electricity is expensive here in the Commonwealth. In 2014, the residential rate was 39% higher than the national average. The industrial and commercial rate was 79% higher than the industrial average. Obviously, that is not good for economic development purposes. In energy overall, we're number two in cost behind our neighbor to the south, Connecticut. Electricity, the story is a little bit better. We are number 34 overall in the country in terms of electricity costs. But the high cost of electricity as driven by our utilities is definitely a concern for the Commonwealth in general in terms of economic development. What drives that? We get 44% of our electricity on average from burning natural gas. That sounds good until you think about that we also heat our homes with natural gas. So when we reach high capacity issue times in the winter when we must burn natural gas to heat our homes, that takes the natural gas away from burning for electricity. Then we switch over to oil. Oil is very expensive for generating electricity and it's not very efficient. So we have really difficult times, especially in the winter when we hit times of capacity. I want to talk about the regional differences. Here in Western Mass, we end up paying a lot more for our electricity than many of our counterparts in Eastern Mass. The Eversource rate that was just announced, they proposed to collect $60 million from Eastern Massachusetts ratepayers and $35 million from Western Mass ratepayers. That sounds good until you do the math on a per meter basis. That's $162 per meter for a Western Mass meter and $50 for an Eastern Mass meter. So the inequity there between a Western Mass ratepayer and an Eastern Mass ratepayer, again, falls on the Western Mass side to pick up the slack. It's also true with National Grid, although they do it a little bit differently. Each zone in National Grid's territory has a capacity tag. The capacity tag in NEMA, as compared to the capacity tag out here in Western Mass, is much, much higher. National Grid socializes that cost across all ratepayers, so in essence, the Western Mass ratepayer is paying for the higher capacity tag in Northeastern Mass. So you're welcome, any senator in Northeastern Mass. What do these two utilities have in common? Well, they're both not Massachusetts corporations. National Grid is based in England. and Eversource is based in Connecticut. So I think we really need to look at our local companies to find a solution for our electricity pricing. And that brings us to our final point. Where does our money go? We spend $22 billion in energy every year. 80% of that flows out of the state. To me, that is a gaping wound on our Commonwealth economy, and I think we have to look internally to be able to fix that. We need to take control of our electricity pricing. We need to take control of our electricity generation. And we do that by investing in local Massachusetts-based companies that are concentrating in the development of renewable technologies here in the Commonwealth. Unfortunately, we spent a lot of energy on solar over the last couple of years. And when I say unfortunately, I mean that about 70% of that was through leasing. 100% of that lease money flows out of state. It all goes to California for the most part. That, although we built a lot of solar, we're not seeing the benefits of that solar from an economic development point of view. So I think the legislature has a job to do and take a pivot at this point. We've done a lot of good with generating some renewable assets here in the Commonwealth, but I think we can do a lot better by supporting our local Massachusetts-based companies to find a way out of this continuous spiral that we find ourselves in with high electricity costs. Local generation can help solve our capacity issues. It could be an economic driver. And here in Western Mass, we have a lot of space and a lot of ingenuity and a lot of good companies to take a leadership role in that. We look forward to working with you on that. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Todd. You know, I'm in month three here of being a state senator. I thank you all for your wisdom in empowering the AG to be an advocate for ratepayers. And so we've been working closely with the Attorney General as this process moves forward, and there's going to be hearings this month ahead. I hope we're not depressing you too much, but we're moving out of that stage of the reality that we face.
That's a vision of hope I just presented. That's a vision of hope.
Yeah, exactly. We're getting there. You know, ultimately, it's we wanted to dwell on that because even personally, there's a level of you know, discomfort that I feel when we're looking at that gap that emerges within the Commonwealth. But we do have a couple of folks who are going to talk about some of the efforts that are being underway in terms of post-industrial development and tourism. So Pat, maybe take on the tourism element.
Sure. So I'm Pat Beaudry. I'm with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission. We're the 43 cities and towns of Hamden and Hampshire County. I'm speaking about tourism in kind of a roundabout way, where a year ago I probably wouldn't have expected to have that be my topic, but I'll tell you a little bit about a project we're working on in our rural communities known as the Hilltowns. The Hilltowns actually stretch from the Connecticut border up to Vermont, New Hampshire, but the six towns we're working with are part of the Gateway Regional School District. And they also have kind of faced the same demographic changes that were described earlier by my colleagues. And what you find in these regional school districts is they make a lot of sense, but if you are continuing to lose population, your overhead's staying where it is, and it's getting more and more of a crunch on these towns to come up with the funding with less students. I want to throw out a completely unverified fact that I heard last week, but the Gateway's Regional School District, their students are about 85% going on to college. So it's not that it's a bad school district. It's a school district that's struggling with the economics of declining population. So the six towns reached out to one another and decided to apply together jointly for the Community Compact program, two prongs, both economic development and regionalization. And on the economic development side, we teamed up with Mass Development and their house doctors, Law and Design, to come up with an economic plan that would give the six-town region a blueprint to move forward. And as we started to engage in this robust public input process, we found some themes. And one of the themes was people kept saying, you know, our state forest is our national scenic Westfield River, our scenic byways. People don't know about them, and if they do, they know about them individually. They know about that state forest, or they know about the canoe race, or they know about, you know, what any number of tourism attractions. And so what we found was that there was this very real low-hanging fruit to come up with a comprehensive plan to brand the region and really make it more of a tourism destination. Now, I think that it would be important for me to throw the disclaimer out that I do not speak on behalf of the group that came out of this effort, which is the Hilltown Collaborative. But I will speak generally to what we feel is that Tourism is a means, not an end. We want people to come up here and create businesses, and I think that as people seek, alternative lifestyles, you can move up and be an attorney in Huntington with access to high-speed internet right now. You can be in the creative economy and see your clients in Northampton up and down the valley, a few days a week, but really work from home. And so we are trying to encourage these sectors, but really the first step in our minds is to have people start coming up on a more regular basis and fall in love. No one moves somewhere where they haven't visited and had a positive experience previously, and that's really where we're going with this. And trying to keep this brief, I would say the last piece of this is, a lot of these businesses that have been there for a long time family-owned businesses, I think they're learning that there needs to be a side hustle to their business model. And so if you are a blueberry farmer, adding that pick-your-own offering so families can come up and pick their own blueberries is a way to expose both the region, but it also provides some real revenue for your farm. Likewise with the people who manufacture furniture, who engrave firearms. There's just so many different sectors that are there that people don't know about, and I think that as people like to experience the products that they're purchasing, I think that actually is going to be a way to move forward economically. And lastly, I would say the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission's involvement in this has been made possible by district local technical assistance. I know the people in the valley who were present heard from me last year. It's an important funding source for us to partner with our communities, and obviously putting together this plan doesn't increase capacity for the six towns to actually implement. And so we're really excited to announce that we were awarded $100,000 in the second round of efficiency and regionalization funding from the Community Compact to hire a community development coordinator for the six towns, who will take the blueprint that's going to be released by Mass Development, I anticipate in the next month or so, and really wake up every single day and figure out how to make these action items happen, work across sectors. And so we're really excited to see this next phase, but I appreciate again the opportunity to speak, and I think for now our hope is that we're successful here and that we can replicate it in rural areas throughout the Commonwealth moving forward.
That's great, thanks. There are two cities in my district. One is Pittsfield, the other is North Adams. And Christine, maybe talk a little bit about a set of challenges, possibilities related to towns going through kind of a post-industrial moment.
So Christine Hurley, Executive Director for Downtown Pittsfielding. I feel a little bit like the brat here because we are doing a lot of really great things in Pittsfield. Everything you see in Downtown Pittsfield is 12 or 15 years new. So prior to that, sort of just after GE left town, it was very dark along North Street. Windows were blocked off because there were no businesses there. So about 12 or 15 years ago, we saw a real shift happen. Lots of investment, a lot of friends helping friends to say, hey, we really have hope for this city. Let's redevelop this building. Lots of public and private partnerships. I know that's kind of a buzzword. It's really the only way we were able to make it happen in downtown Pittsfield. The arts really invigorated our area, arts and culture. We continue to need more and more arts and culture support in order to thrive. It's a real economic driver for us. And certainly support from the state with our infrastructure improvements has made a real difference. So now what we're seeing as a big win for us is development of the upper floors into market rate housing. Foot traffic is incredibly challenging for our small businesses in downtown Pittsfield. So because we are a tourism destination, you might see a little bit of an increase in foot traffic because of our two large theaters in downtown. And then the other times of the year, it's very slow, and our small businesses struggle through the other pieces of the year. So the only way that developers, we have beautiful historic buildings in downtown, and the only way our developers can really rehab those upper floors is through some pretty creative financing situations, help from the state, help from the local government, real partnerships together. So that's really our next big focus. I think all of these challenges that the others on the panel face certainly impact the growth that we feel in downtown Pittsfield. So the more we can work together to help each other to keep building on this momentum is really important to downtown. And it's never over. You know, we've been working really hard over the last 12 or 15 years, and we continue to have to push because, you know, we don't want that focus to die. It is the largest growth area we've experienced in Pittsfield. So
I think that's thanks for that. Next, we're going to switch. We're on the home stretch here. We're going to switch to initiatives to try to grapple with some of these dynamics. We have Superintendent Bunakani, whose last name you may or may not recognize. His brother is a former state senator, and he's leading several efforts. Take it away.
Good morning. Michael Bunakani. I've been superintendent at Mohawk for about 12 years now. I speak from Ludlow within my district. And can you hear me now?
Yeah.
So I work for the Mohawk Trail Regional School District, been there for about a decade now, so I've been thoroughly immersed in the issues of regional school districts. I realize that our part of the budget is about half to 60% in some cases, so we're a huge part of town budgets. I won't spend a lot of time on why we're financially unsustainable. I think that's a story everybody has heard here, declining enrollment, flat Chapter 70, but still rising costs because we lack economy of scale. If I have a class of 20 kids and I lose 5 kids, I still need a 1.0 teacher. I can't hire 3/4 of a teacher. So what I'd like to use this time for is to focus on what we're trying to do to help ourselves. Things that may involve money and things that may not involve money. So as examples, beyond my role within Mohawk, what I'd like to also point out is that I'm chair of the Massachusetts Rural Schools Coalition, which is a newly organized group over the past 12 months or so, largely made up of superintendents from Western Massachusetts, but we have had at least one brave soul coming from Eastern Mass. And of course, the Cape is experiencing similar issues that we're facing. So we're looking for ways to help ourselves. And we're looking at ways to do that might not cost money, and an example of that would be legislation that would relieve us of the 180-day school year. If we could have legislation that just required time on learning, the same amount of time on learning, then we could really begin to look at innovations. Of course, we're dependent on what happens with technology. If we had a 4-day school week, for instance, which is what this legislation would enable, we would look at ways to save money on transportation and operating costs. Broadband would then become critical for us to find ways to do remote learning within that context as well as in other contexts. So that would be a high leverage, no cost opportunity for us. Otherwise, we know we need to find ways to share services in roles that are not contact with students. We need to find ways to share superintendents, business administrators, curriculum directors, directors of people personnel, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And so there are ways to do this. So in terms of what I think is seed money, which would be on the level of 50 to 100K, there are different models that we're looking at to find ways to share those services. So I look to you to help us to help ourselves. And we can do this without having to ask for a fund. And I understand where the state of the state is. And so I'm not looking for the state to save the day here. But I think that I can speak for my colleagues who are looking for partners here to just give us some tools, some enabling tools, so that we can, in fact, continue to support our kids. Because I worry about the gateways of the world, which have already closed schools and have hit the wall again. And you've got people wearing multiple hats, like the superintendent, who's also the technology coordinator, and the chief cook and bottle washer. We know you can't do that. Jake's sitting to my left. So before we start to really lose the quality of our schools, we're in this zone right now where we can do something about it. So I look forward to partnering with all of you. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. And there is one specific example of that, which is the Berkshire Education Task Force. Dr. Eppelwein, you have a lot you could talk about coming from Mass College of Liberal Arts and your work. But maybe that could be one useful emphasis, but I'll hand it over to you.
Absolutely. So Jake Eppelwein from MCLA, I'm the dean at the college, former superintendent in Pittsfield, lifelong resident of Dalton, home of Crane & Company, great company. So I'm glad to talk to you here today about this organized group that has come together about 2.5 years ago called the Berkshire County Education Task Force. We are tackling this puzzle of public education in a geographically expansive county like Berkshire County, understanding all the things that have been mentioned, which are population decline, flat declining revenue, and as a result of that, shrinking programming, and what we see is a leakage of potential quality and outcomes for our kids. So over the past 2.5 years, we have tackled and are tackling this work in three phases. Our first phase was to actually do a comprehensive benchmarking of what's occurring in Berkshire County. So understanding our building use, staffing patterns, classroom patterns, program patterns, finances, and everything in between. We partnered with the University of Massachusetts Donahue Institute to help produce that study, which was published this past fall. We have transitioned, actually with your support, into phase two, in which we are partnering with district management group to explore modeling exercises based on those frameworks. Our four models that we're trying to figure out, and we understand that these models are not all the options we have available, but they are what will occur in Berkshire County if we continue to do nothing in examining our educational structures. Two is, how might we advance, as Michael pointed out, additional collaborative opportunities and shared services across the county. Already that has yielded a North County a successful grant that is exploring a special ed collaborative in the northern part of our county. The third model is, what would happen if we started to combine districts that are geographically proximal? So Elees and Lenox, North Adams and Williamstown, folks that have sort of driving distance capacity. Then the fourth model is, what would happen if we looked at our entire county as a school district and or three subset school districts. So rather than continue to have water cooler conversations, we're trying to dig into the research of understanding what has happened around the nation that we can borrow from, and how might we attack this problem regionally.
So that was impressive.
That was quick. In phase two.
No, I don't. I want to take the balance of your time for sure, but we only have two more. You had a question though.
Yeah, I just want to say phase two will hopefully be published at some point this summer. That's our goal. And I did want to emphasize that we are doing right now, phase two has a huge outreach component. We're interacting with, we've got 40 meetings set up around our region to talk with parents, community members, business members, really to get their feedback on what are their hopes and aspirations for our county, recognizing that the only way to stop population leakage is to lead with your schools. High quality educational systems that both attract folks in and also generate an educated workforce to support those businesses.
Literally, just to demonstrate this, on the way to meeting everyone in Amherst this morning, I was on the phone with a school committee member in Adams Cheshire that made a decision to close an elementary school 2 weeks ago. Beth, you get almost the last word, because there's a similar dynamic happening by towns to try to explore shared services and other difficult regulations that and their impact on small towns from the state level. Go ahead.
Beth Bandy, I'm the chair of the select board of the town of Charlemont, and we are, about a year ago, we started doing something we're calling small town summits. Like Adam just mentioned, and the two gentlemen next to me, we're talking about sort of how do we help ourselves. A lot of the emphasis of the small town summit was, we knew in our town that we were banging our head against the wall about a set of issues, and we assumed we were not the only select board members in the rural communities around the state that were having the same issue. So we decided to get together select board members and finance committee members from small towns around Western Mass to talk about what are the common challenges we have and how can we work together to kind of deal with some of those issues. And I want to say just briefly that group, we've had people coming from about 20 different communities around Western Mass, from Berkshire, Franklin, and Hampshire counties. But the issues we're talking about here are relevant to the small towns all across the state. And when we usually think about Massachusetts as being very urban or suburban, but there are about 170 communities, so almost half of all the municipalities in the state are rural. So the issues that we're dealing with here, our little group of these resonate with communities all across the state. So we started out talking about how can we share services. We have a couple of things that have come out of that, where we have towns talking about sharing, for instance, my town and our neighboring town of Holly, where we just signed an agreement to share some highway equipment because we don't each have to buy the same pieces of equipment, we can share. And that's one of the things that came out of some of our initial meetings on this. We also have some towns that are working together on sharing police services. So we're trying to find ways where we can sort of cut some costs and come together to not duplicate the, you know, reinvent the wheel in every town. But there's we're all about doing things for ourselves, but at the same time, there's a limit to, there are some things that we need some help with. And if, in December, we met to put together a list of legislative priorities that we felt really would, if these issues were addressed legislatively, that would really make a big difference for all of our small towns. It's a long list. We have handouts, so my select board member, Toby Gould, ran away, has the... Yeah, it'll be a long ride back. So the full list is here, so you can, I don't want to go into detail about everything, but the big themes are that we, you know, certainly broadband, I can probably say that after every single point, of broadband, broadband, broadband. Without broadband here, we are really suffering. We have very limited tax base. We don't have a lot to build on if we can't have that important infrastructure in place to help businesses file their taxes and do their marketing, the types of getting the word out about tourism. We have a very recreation-based economy up where I am, and it's really important for folks in our area to be able to have internet access so they can just reach people in Boston and New York and Connecticut and say, hey, come on up. But we can't, if we don't have access to broadband, we can't do that. And there are implications for broadband and all sort of aspects of our economic development. We also focused on rural schools. All the stuff that Michael was talking about before, we're certainly, in all of our towns, we're looking at somewhere around 40, 50, 60% of the budgets totally taken up by school issues. And we're very much supportive of trying to, any kind of legislative efforts to deal with budget issues related to the schools. And one thing we talked about a little bit at our last meeting is about sparsity aid or rurality factor, where there was 34 states around the country have some sort of formula that they put in place to help the small communities deal with the issues that Michael was addressing before. We don't have that here. That would be something that might really help us going forward in Massachusetts. We talked a little bit about, there's an item on here about open meeting law, but more broadly this is about the challenges of running small towns. We have offices that are open, you know, it depends, it varies. We talked about some of our small towns, you know, the town that had 125 people you mentioned earlier, you know, their offices open, you know, a couple hours a week. It's not really that big of an operation. So that's kind of one end of the spectrum. But even in the bigger of our small towns out here, we have very limited number of staff hours to do a lot of different types of things. And so as regulations increase and the number of things we have to do goes up, we don't necessarily have the people power to do these things. So that the open meeting law piece on here is related to that, but it's sort of a symptom of a larger problem. We don't have the money to pay for bigger staff to handle a lot of the issues that are coming up. And the last couple of, there were two more items on here about pilot programs and zip codes. These are really about the financial resources that our towns have. We have some of our communities in, well, around the state, but definitely out here, like towns like Holly, John Sears is on the select board, and Holly is in the back there. But some of these towns have 40, 50% of the town landmass is owned by the state. And from year to year, the pilot payments for the land, it fluctuates pretty significantly. So if you have a very small tax base in general, and half of your sort of your landmass is owned by the state, you can't really count on a consistent amount of money coming in. That's a huge problem trying to, when you know that there are the expenses coming in. We need to pay the school budgets, we need to pay for highway equipment, all these sorts of things. Without some sort of consistency across the board with how the pilot payments are made and how much is going to come in each year, and also just for agency to agency, the you know, different agencies pay different amounts for the land. So some towns are getting nothing for the land in their town, and other towns are getting quite a bit. So it sort of, it depends on where you are, which agencies purchase land in your town, and what the financial reality is for that year, how much money comes in. But that fluctuation, when you have these very, very tiny budgets in our towns, having that kind of fluctuation causes a lot of havoc. So we were looking for some kind of consistency there. And then the last piece, I understand there's some progress on the zip codes front of some of our towns, yeah.
To the Senate President?
Yeah, so.
We're getting there.
So it's just really important. I mean, we have a couple of people here from Buckland. I know they felt the pain around zip code issue, but this is where towns share, have zip codes for, I'm in the town of Charlemont, but my zip code is for Shelburne Falls, which isn't even really a town. Buckland is also, you have
we started this phrase, I know. You can blame this on us.
And but how are, so when in your town, the issue was that you had meals tax, you were expected to get revenue back from the meals tax question.
We asked, what would our meals tax revenue, the local option tax? And they said, you'd get nothing. You have no restaurants. I said, I'm looking at six of them. No, those are in Shelburne. Because we share the Shelburne Falls zip code, which is in a town.
So there's little things like that, but that doesn't cost anything. So those sorts of things, it would be, not to simplify it. I know that there are a lot of reasons why it's that way, and there's some technological changes that would have to happen in addition to. There's a lot of work that needs to be done to fix it, but it's not. It's a matter of kind of seeing that there's an issue there and just sort of teasing out what's in line.
Perfect. Now, we're on the last one here. We have two people with us. Jonathan Butler is going to bring it home, wrap it up in a creative vision, and really make us all feel good about this event. He, before being the president and CEO of One Berkshire, he worked for some guy named Benjamin Downing. I haven't heard of him, but apparently everyone knows who he is. Take it over, John.
When I got an email yesterday, it says I was going to provide vision at the end of everybody else's remarks. I said, oh, okay. So I'll try to be really concise and just kind of summarize a little bit of what we talked about here. And just so you're all aware, our organization, One Berkshire, is basically our regional chamber of commerce in the Berkshires. We're the leading economic business organization. We have about 1,300 member businesses. We're the REDU and the RTC for the Berkshires. So we're kind of in the middle of everything. And in my background, I was also a town manager in the Berkshires after I worked for Senator Downing, so I've kind of been in the center of all these different topics in different ways over the last decade. So one thing that I wanted to kind of get into was just the thing in the Berkshires that we're often recognized as being really good at, from previous administrations, the current administration, when we have delegations like this out here, is collaboration. We're very good at that in Franklin County, Hampshire County, all throughout Western Mass, certainly in the Berkshires. We're good at pulling together key stakeholders to rally around certain issues, put together alliances, task force committees, and come up with solutions or paths towards solutions to many of these things that we've talked about today. I think one of the opportunities that we have working with the Commonwealth is maybe to even strengthen our strategic partnership on how we take those recommendations and solutions and turn them into action. I think, recently with the change in administrations and as the state prioritizes different things at different times, we often feel like work goes into some of these challenges, but we're sidestepping. We continue to reinvestigate things rather than moving forward towards action. And I think on a number of the things that we talked about today, some of these different experts at the table in their different areas were really offering specific paths that we need to follow. So something to consider. I wanted to talk a little bit too about, I think, just our perception in Western Mass. We're very proud of the progress in Massachusetts. Massachusetts has, we have, unprecedented economic growth right now. The investment inside the 495 belt is tremendous. There's great things happening. The Commonwealth was just recognized as a leading place to live by a major publication. We're proud of that in Western Mass. We're part of that, but I don't think we sense the same level of prosperity out here that some of our neighbors in Eastern Mass are feeling. There's some economics to that, and it's generally an economic conversation. Three areas that I just wanted to emphasize, kind of hit on all of them a little bit, but one is energy costs. The economics of energy out here for our economy continues to be a major challenge. The points that you raised were, on point. This most recent Eversource rate increase is going to it's a 3-to-1 ratio in terms of in the impact of the increase. So, your average rate payer on a $10 bill in Eastern Mass is going to be an $11 bill. In Western Mass, it's going to become a $13 bill. If you scale that up to a manufacturer with $1 million energy budget, you're talking about the types of increases that can cripple businesses. So that's an item that I think we really need to be conscious of in terms of how we approach that. The other piece is I just want to mention workforce. When you talk to the employers in Western Massachusetts that are on a trajectory where they can grow, workforce continues to be a major issue. There's a perception that we need more jobs in the Berkshires or in Western Mass. We'd love to have more jobs and to diversify our economy, but I know right now in Berkshire County we have almost 1,800 jobs posted. Many of them are quality jobs. We don't have the talent within our workforce to fill them. General Dynamics, which is the second largest employer in Berkshire County, has about 1,600 employees and continues to grow. They've hired over 200 people in consecutive calendar years. and they're hiring right now. They have over 100 open positions. It's constant hiring because they can't recruit or develop the workforce in the region. There's opportunities there, you know, to work with our community colleges and state colleges and strengthen that whole equation. And the last piece, I won't get into any more detail, but just the school funding and regionalization piece, the work that's being done by the Berkshire County Education Task Force, and that's being done up in Franklin and Hampshire County, is critical, and it's an economic development issue. We have employers trying to attract talent, and we have young families looking at the trajectory of our school districts, and they don't like what they see. We need to fix this. It's a problem that it starts with the schools. It becomes a municipal problem and their ability to provide services, and now it's started to shift into becoming an economic issue. I wanted to really quickly talk about just one example of where I think the realities between Eastern and Western Mass being very different. And this is just one example. I'm sure Senator Lesser or Senator Sear from the Cape could also have other examples, but the idea of taking one formula to solve a problem economically in the Berkshires or in Massachusetts doesn't always work for us in Western Mass. And one example of that is actually tourism dollars. The governor just made a cut across the board mid-year that cut RTC funding in half for this year. And it was obviously done based upon the state's formula of how RTCs are funded, but that was ultimately an imbalanced cut to those districts that depend on that. In the Berkshires, tourism is a backbone industry for us. It's revitalized our downtowns, it's made the region a cooler place to live, it's attracted hundreds of or tens of billions of dollars in housing investments in our downtown, which has made our communities more attractive to other types of industries and employers. So that cut in the Berkshires or on the Cape is imbalanced compared to the impact that it has in other parts of the state. So that's just one example of thinking differently. And I'll also attach to that out in Berkshires, we're right next door to New York State. That's investing massively in how they talk about visiting New York, starting your business in New York, and we're up against that competitively on a daily basis. Our neighboring county, Columbia County, which is beautiful and is a nice place to visit, actually markets themselves as we're next to the Berkshires. And they're spending more money than we are talking about their region. So ultimately, what does all this mean? The opportunity, I think, is in building an environment where our existing businesses can stay, they can invest, and they can diversify. You've heard about a lot of different support pieces, infrastructure, energy costs, solving education funding, workforce and talent alignment, and all of those pieces for us are part of that built environment in Western Mass. We have to make that environment stronger by working in a more strategic way between our local efforts and our statewide support. And that's the key to letting the businesses that are here now grow, but also having an environment that's much more healthy for future business growth and attraction. So I thank you all for your time today and for coming out and visiting us and the opportunity to share a little bit of insight.
Thanks again to the panelists.
And thanks to all of you for coming and participating. We had hoped to have a little chance for a back and forth. The conversation element of the Commonwealth Conversations is happening tonight at 6:15 at UMass. But my emails, and we can certainly share any feedback through the process, because unfortunately I've been getting texts and waves and other things from the back of the room as we're already behind in our schedule. So apologies for that. So thanks again, and thanks to colleagues for enduring and listening through this.